September
5th, I think. Yeah. Boy, how time flies.
Yeah. 2007. Well, Roger, thank you for being on Case International. Tell us how you got into reggae music and how you started your archives.
When I think about how I got into reggae music, I have to think back about 20 years earlier, really, because I was born in Brooklyn in 1942. And so I was 12 years of age when Alan Freed came to New York City, and rock and roll really was born for all of us at that point. And every night when I was a kid, I would listen to him, and then when his show was off, I'd go down to the black end of the dial and listen to Jocko Henderson and Symphony Sid with his jazz show. And it was all with the radio under the covers, you know, because the radio had a light on the dial, and my mother could see the light under the crack of my bedroom door and know I was listening to the radio and I was supposed to be asleep. And so I had to hide it under the covers. And I just fell under the spell primarily of black music when I was a kid. I can't explain it. It was just something that my blood responded to. And I used to go to those incredible doo-wop shows in New York and Brooklyn that Alan Freed threw three times a year. And in the 60s, of course, like everybody else, I got involved in a little more conscious music, the Dillons and the people whose music was being used for revolutionary purposes. And by 1970, I think the lawyers and the accountants had taken over the music business and emasculated it. The last great 60s album was What's Going On by Marvin Gaye. And after that, it was disco and glam rock and a whole lot of crap. And I was really consciously trying to find something to fill the void. And I read an article in Rolling Stone in 1973 in the summer by an Australian journalist named Michael Thomas called The Wild Side of Paradise. It later became a book that he did with the photographer Adrian Boot that was originally called Babylon on a Thin Wire, and later retitled Jaw Revenge. But it was some of the most intense writing I'd ever heard about music, and it introduced me to a whole new topic, reggae. Obviously, I was into pop music, so I knew about My Boy Lollipop, but nobody ever called that ska. And I knew about the Israelites in the summer of 69, but nobody ever said that's reggae. And it just seemed like a pop novelty. The article made the music sound so fascinating that I had to go right out and find some, and I found a used copy of Catch a Fire for $2.25 in a store in Berkeley where I was living. And the next night I saw The Harder They Come in a smoky little theater on the north side of campus and bought the soundtrack on the way home. And my life literally changed from that moment forever. So discovering reggae music that way through the vinyl led me to search it out. Luckily, we could still get a lot of imported records in those times, and Berkeley had some of the best record stores in the country. But there was also a record store on Fillmore Street in San Francisco called Trenchtown Records, run by a guy called Ruel Mills, who had been an old spar of Bob's from Kingston. And that's where I bought my first singles, Alton Ellis and Ross Michael and the Sons of Negus and the Techniques and Slim Smith and the Uniques and great rock steady stuff. And he had a great influence on my early taste. He had immaculate taste himself and only imported the really good rootical stuff. And in 76, my wife Mary and I decided we would go to Jamaica to try to find all these records we'd been reading about. That way, through the vinyl, led me to search it out. Luckily, we could still get a lot of imported records in those times, and Berkeley had some of the best record stores in the country. But there was also a record store on Fillmore Street in San Francisco called Trenchtown Records, run by a guy called Ruel Mills, who had been an old spar of Bob's from Kingston. And that's where I bought my first singles, Alton Ellis and Ross Michael and the Sons of Negus and the Techniques and Slim Smith and the Uniques and great rock steady stuff. And he had a great influence on my early taste. He had immaculate taste himself and only imported the really good rootical stuff. And in 76, my wife Mary and I decided we would go to Jamaica to try to find all these records we'd been reading about but had no access to. And the week we arrived, Michael Manley declared a national state of emergency, threw the opposition in jail with no charges, and put tanks on all the major crossroads. I thought I was back in Saigon during the war, and all I wanted to do was go find records. And we went to an almost deserted Kingston. I mean, it was under heavy manners for sure. And we're dropped off in front of a back street shack that Bob Marley had at the time, a little Tuff Gong record shack. And they had no Bob Marley records for sale. They had no Peter Tosh records for sale, even though the sign out front said Intel, Diplo, Tuff Gong, Solomonic. They did have two singles by Bunny. And we were taken that day by a fellow we met on the street to Jimmy Cliff's house, and met Joe Higgs and Chynna Smith and Ernest Ranglin, a whole bunch of people that I would later understand were, you know, immortals. And they were really nice. We spent two or three hours at the house talking about reggae music, and you know, to be accepted by stars like that was overwhelming to us. We had seen Joe and Jimmy play the Roxy in Los Angeles the year before in 75. So that just whetted my appetite more. And then a major turning point came again for me in 1978 when I met Hank Holmes. Hank was a remarkable collector here in Los Angeles who had never left the city in his life and had at that point about 8,000 Jamaican records. Too long a story to go into to tell you how he did it for almost nothing. And he turned me on to and met Joe Higgs and Chynna Smith and Ernest Ranglin, a whole bunch of people that I would later understand were, you know, immortals. And they were really nice. We spent two or three hours at the house talking about reggae music, and you know, to be accepted by stars like that was overwhelming to us. We had seen Joe and Jimmy play the Roxy in Los Angeles the year before in 75. So that just whetted my appetite more. And then a major turning point came again for me in 1978 when I met Hank Holmes. Hank was a remarkable collector here in Los Angeles who had never left the city in his life and had at that point about 8,000 Jamaican records. Too long a story to go into to tell you how he did it for almost nothing. And he turned me on to some real obscure groups like Well Pleased and Satisfied and artists like Roy Shirley and Ja Caretaker and people that, you know, folks in Jamaica didn't even know about. And I figured that with my broadcast background, I had started as a broadcaster on WVOX in New York in 1961. Hank had a great amount of stories that he told, and I figured between the two of us we could do a great radio show, and we tried for a year to get on the air. Closest we came was the Pacifica station, the great bastion of liberalism, and we did three audition shows on the air for them that got great response, but they told us they couldn't put us on the air playing Jamaican music because we were white. So in desperation we went to a tiny station over on the west side of LA called KCRW, and we got on there, and the show became an instant success. The first fund drive, because it was a non-commercial station that we were part of, our 3 hours made what the entire 10-day fund drive had made the previous year. So our time was doubled. We had a four-hour-a-week shift on Sunday afternoons, and the whole city listened in the early 80s. Everybody was discovering it at the same time, and our show was the catalyst. It was like a weekend seminar, a graduate course. It was like a party. You could walk along the beach in the early 80s in Santa Monica, and you wouldn't need a radio to hear the reggae beat, because everybody on the beach was listening to it. And so we felt a responsibility, and we were both very interested in the roots music. We weren't interested in slackness. We had time, because we were commercial free, to investigate the artists' careers. I mean, Hank had such a phenomenal collection that people like Alton Ellis would come, and Hank would put down, you know, five dozen records by him, and, you know, at least five or six of those Alton had never even heard before, never knew were released, and that would lead to some interesting discussions. And we had, ultimately, the station got a much bigger signal and moved to a new headquarters, and we got a wonderful live music studio so we could start doing concerts live on the show on Sundays. But the great joy for me was when somebody would walk in with an acoustic guitar and just sit and strum their history to it. And so we felt a responsibility, and we were both very interested in the roots music. We weren't interested in slackness. We had time, because we were commercial free, to investigate the the artists' careers. I mean, Hank had such a phenomenal collection that people like Alton Ellis would come, and Hank would put down, you know, 5 dozen records by him, and, you know, at least 5 or 6 of those Alton had never even heard before, never knew were released, and that would lead to some interesting discussions. And we had, ultimately, the station got a much bigger signal and moved to a new headquarters, and we got a wonderful live music studio so we could start doing concerts live on the show on Sundays. But the great joy for me was when somebody would walk in with an acoustic guitar and just sit and strum their history to us. And we made tapes of every one of those shows. I have downstairs 400 Sundays worth of Reggae Beat broadcasts. So I think it's a total of about 1,400 hours. And that led to other things. In 1980, a Trinidadian man named Chili Charles, who had been a very successful drummer in England in the early 70s and part of the reggae scene there and knew Bob Marley from the early days, came to the station and said, you know, you've got all these people coming in, what are you doing to document them? And I said, well, we tape the shows. And he says, yeah, but I mean, then you go out in the parking lot and you talk to them for an hour. Why don't I come down when you have guests and film them? Sure, why not? It turns out that an awful lot of the things we filmed became part of history. There are some wonderful early interviews with Peter. There's a remarkable interview with Joseph Hill, Culture, where he tells a story of something that happened to him just a few months before, where he was mugged on the way back from a groundation in Bull Bay and thrown into the ground with the barrel of a rifle in his neck and the guy about to murder him. And all of a sudden, a little 2-inch-tall Haile Selassie appears before him and says, "What, Joe, you're going to lose faith now, boy?" And at that point, one of the gunmen turns to the other and says, "You know who this is? This is Joe Hill. We can't kill Joe Hill, because if we kill Joe Hill, when we get back to the ghetto, they're going to kill us." And the other guy says, "Oh, yes, we can." He says, "Well, if you shoot him, I'll shoot you." And finally, they decide not to shoot him at all. And they just take all his money and his shoes and his watch and his jewelry and everything and ride off. And a week later, the police find him and kill him. So that's an incredible piece of footage. That's going to be in my new book, in the Reggae Scrapbook that I did with Peter Simon. We're going to have an hour of DVD interviews from the early days of the LA Reggae television show, and that's one of the priceless pieces that we're including in it. Yeah, and also Peter will be in the book talking about all the plots on his life that he knows are out there now. So the LA Reggae television show started from fairly humble beginnings and lasted on and off till 2003. Chili passed away in 2005. The next major thing was in 1982 when Cece Smith, a woman who had befriended the show and come to answer our telephones on Sunday afternoons and to do the calendar of events, said, you know, why don't we start a little newsletter or something, because there's so much reggae beginning to happen in LA and everybody wants to know where they can find it. Maybe we should put out a little newsletter. So I got on the air one Sunday and said, if you'd like us to send you a newsletter of events, send us your name and address. And next week we had 300 letters, and Cece said, what should I do? Should I start a magazine? And I said, sure, Cece, start a magazine. And that's how the Reggae Beat began. It was a one-page